I don't really want to waste any more time in bringing on our guest. Our guest is named Carolyn, and my oh my, she is quite an individual. We've spoken several times prior to this program, and she has probably more understanding of the kingdom of darkness from a personal experience than anyone I've personally spoken with. Now, of course, I've heard others talk and heard other testimonies of various related issues and read books and so forth that have exposed me to a lot of the information and background that she's familiar with. But to hear it firsthand, to speak with her, to hear her heart, is something truly incredible. And more incredible than the things that she's going to be sharing with us tonight is the testimony of the power of Jesus to break her free and to keep her free and to bring healing and to continue to use her in spite of everything that she has experienced and so forth. So she is what you would call an Illuminati defector. She was born into an illumined family, so to speak, and these are things that she's going to be explaining to us personally. So I don't want to overdo this introduction, and at this point, I'm just going to go ahead and bring her on. Carolyn, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks, Daniel, for giving me this opportunity to share some of my testimony. I've been trying to write it for a long time, but it's really not that easy to write about, and I just think it'll be a lot easier with your biblical understanding and your solid faith to help make my message the message that I would like people to know that I'm trying to get it across. You have that spiritual understanding that is needed for this type of a message. So I thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, Daniel.
Thanks. Thank you, Carolyn. I want to begin at the beginning, and you know, prior to this show, we've talked about, you know, how we're going to approach this, and I'm really excited about the way we're approaching this because, you know, I look forward to hopefully having you on several times to move through a lot of the information that you have, because there is no way, and for those of you that are listening, you'll understand once we get into this, there is absolutely no way to communicate her story in 2 hours, 3 hours, or 4 hours. her story is jam-packed with experiences. As a matter of fact, you could say three lifetimes in one for the amount of experiences that she has had. So I want to begin in the beginning, and to preface what she's going to tell us, I want to read a verse out of the Bible, which I believe gives credibility to what she is going to share. And it comes from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 1. Beginning in verse 4, it says, "The word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee, and before thou camest forth from the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations." And in that verse, what God is telling Jeremiah is that, really, there was some kind of pre-birth experience. He says, "Before I formed you in the belly, I knew you." And there's no other detail given as to what that looked like. What did it look like for God to know Jeremiah? What was that experience all about? Jeremiah may have not even known what that experience was about. But nonetheless, the Bible is clear that God knew Jeremiah before Jeremiah was formed in his mother's belly. And with this said, I'm going to let Carolyn begin us on her personal journey, her memories regarding her life. So go ahead, Carolyn, and take us on our journey.
This is a part of my testimony that only a few people have heard, because it is kind of, a lot of people don't feel like it fits into typical Christianity. And I haven't wanted to distract anybody away from Jesus Christ and that solid foundational truth about him. And we'll be getting more into that and why he is, why I know he's real and why it's so important to me to get that message out. But with Daniel's help, I think that it's significant to be able to talk about my first memories, which were actually before I was born. And the reason that I think it might be important is because the message here is that we are very, very important to God. There is, we do have a Heavenly Father, the creator of the universe. We're all individual. We're even different than individual snowflakes, that God created each and every one of us with a special purpose in mind. He gave us a spiritual name. None of us have the same name. None of us have the same purpose. We're all just so very, very special to our Heavenly Father, and none of us are less loved than another, that we are His creation. And that's something that that Lucifer, Satan, does not want humanity to know, doesn't want them to know how special they are. So my first memory was, I don't remember, I always called it the heavenlies. I don't remember much about them, about it, before. What I do remember is everything was full of life. Everything was light. Everything that was living was connected to God Himself. He was everywhere. He was in everything. His presence was His presence was like life, this energizing life. It was the life that we were in the heavenlies. There are many other people. I call them people because they look like people in the heavenlies. Well, I got a call. His voice. It's like you can feel him and see him. You can't see him physically like a person, but it's like he's so strong and present that it's like you know him, you almost see his face. But there was a call that there was something important that he wanted me to do. I was to report to a certain place in the heavenlies. I reported there. There was a counselor there. I might as well just consider him to be like an angel, although he didn't look like a lot of people think of angels as being very, very tall. He was an average height man, average build, dark hair. He was my representative before God to present an offer to come to this earth, that there were, at a certain place and time on earth, individuals were being sent in. And this particular mission, I don't know, I don't really want to call it a mission. I don't really know what else to call it right now, but it was just an opportunity.
Okay.
That I was told it was, my personality suited it. I didn't have to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But God, I had a feeling that God wanted me to do this. He was hoping that I would take this opportunity. I was shown, shown several different types of lifetimes that a type of humans can have, people can have. One was very easy, one was a medium lifetime, and one was a very, very difficult one. And what I was told, this was the one that I was most suited for, that it would be equivalent to what three human beings would experience in one lifetime. It was going to be a lifetime full of experiences that it would be like having three people's worth of lifetime experiences in one lifetime. I was told it'd be very difficult, and that God would need to intervene and help me at times. So before I said yes, it was like if you've ever pictured being out west, and a lot of people maybe listening to this program will be out west, but I've never been out there and seen this, but this is how it was in how God opened the heavenlies to show me this. It's like I was standing on a plateau up high above a open expanse of like land on earth, just nothing out there, but I was high up looking out, and then it was like a screen sort of thing appeared in the sky where it showed me what my family would be like, what my experiences in this life would be like, and some of the obstacles that I would have to overcome.
Wow.
I saw it all. I don't remember it all, but I remember certain parts of it. mm-hmm. that have been like my life here that helps me know that I'm on track at times, or many times I'm not sure I am, but I saw this, I recognized that it was a challenge, and I agreed that, yes, I'd want to do it. But my personality there in the heavenlies was the personality that I am now, except mm-hmm. I'm much more humble now. I thought if I had determination enough to do something, I could do it no matter what. And I was determined that, yes, I'll do this. It was a blessing that to be offered this, but it was like a gift from God. It was like he wanted to gift me with the opportunity. Mm. And he let me know he'd be there to help me. Well, I was hoping that I would not need his help, and I actually believe that I wouldn't need his help. So I found out a lot differently after this life. It was very, very, very hard. So
wow.
That was my last. That's my last memory in the heavenlies. But I cannot uh-huh. tell you how beautiful it was, how strong God's love is for each and every single one of us. Mm. That's what I came out of with that experience. If it isn't real, I can't say mm-hmm. it wasn't real.
Mm-hmm.
Because I will say this part, there have been times in my life I have needed God to help me out. He has supernaturally saved me even before mm-hmm. I was out of the evil organization. Mm-hmm. I have had angelic help. And several times in my life, that same counselor person, angel, that was my advisor, has shown up in my dreams to warn me of something that was going to happen and tell me what to do. One other mm-hmm. time he came to me and told me why God allowed something to happen in my life, which made
wow.
perfect sense. You know,
wow.
when, but the dreams have been short, and I haven't had any, it's been years since that's happened. Also, the same being appeared in a friend of mine's dream to tell her at one point in my life that my life was in danger.
Wow.
And actually showed her where I was living. That's a whole nother story. But that, so I have to think that there's a good chance that those memories were real.
Wow. And thank you so much, Carolyn, for introducing us like that. This is a beautiful story. And, you know, for those of you that are listening, one of the things that is true of Carolyn is that because of her background, which she'll explain to us, she is a product of dissociation, which always presents the possibility that some memories are implanted, which is why she states the reasons for her believing that these memories have a basis in reality. And so that's really where I want to go next, is kind of right into your family and talking about what kind of family you were born into, which is unique, and the dynamics of it. And just to kind of like introduce it, why don't you give us a little bit of information about your father's genealogy, and then I know that you could probably talk about that for hours, but, you know, maybe just 5 or 10 minutes, some general things, some general elements of your mom's genealogy, some of the things that they were involved in, so people have an idea of what you were born into.
Okay. I don't know that much. I don't know much about my father's genealogy. I haven't looked into that. I do know that he did have certain experiences that would... Well, he was... his experiences tell me that there was more going on in his family line than it's just obvious that things were in his family line, may have skipped a generation, but he had his supernatural experiences. He also was used by the government, and he's one of the statistics from the human experimentation that was going on during World War II. Not, you know, people want to call it Nazi Germany was doing this. It was probably a global thing. I know that my dad and some other people were in the United States in the Navy and were subjected to experimentation, And I believe mind control also. But
wow.
And then we'll get into that another time. But his background suggests that there were things already going on in the family. I have family members that are still living. That's another reason why I don't want to get too much into that. My mother's side, though, is more clear to me. I was told that many generations, founders of the United States, I just have a lot of members that are founders of the United States, and there's streets and cities named after them, a couple of presidents, advisors. But a lot of people in the organization aren't well known. They may not have surnames that people recognize. A lot of people are kind of like background people. My family line I knew of as a lot of them were serving in the same division that I was serving in, and not just in the physical realm, but in the supernatural. And not everybody that serves in the organization is even aware that this section exists.
Wow.
So I was brought up to believe, and of course I had no reason not to, you know, I was seeing things from the supernatural from the time I was, I guess I can remember, since infancy. I kind of lost my train of thought here.
It's okay. Just pick up earliest memories as an infant.
I remember I probably was only, I might have been a week old, maybe.
Yeah.
I know as a newborn.
Wow.
I remember being in my cradle in the bedroom, and my mother came to get me, take me outside and into the rest of the house. They're having a party there. I saw all the people. I mean, it's like a photographic memory of who was there, what they were wearing. They were carrying glasses in their hands. I know now that they're martini glasses. It was more like a semi-formal affair in the house. I don't know what the occasion was, but I assume it must have been around Christmas time. Maybe it was a Christmas party because I was a newborn, and I was born in December. So that's the only thing I can figure about that. But that my first memory was that people came over to see my mother to look at me. She was bringing me out to show some of the guests, and I could actually read their thoughts.
Wow!
And I'm thinking that this is not so unnatural for a newborn baby. I really do think that babies are much more sensitive to their surroundings than adults want to even believe. But I was sensitive to my surroundings. I had the five physical senses plus the sixth sense, where I was sensitive to people's thoughts. And I knew that there's a man that came toward me. I knew the difference of male and female, even at that point. I knew that he was saying, "What a pretty baby." But he was thinking, "What an ugly baby."
Oh, my.
And I didn't like it. You know, and I didn't like it because the fact that he thought I was ugly. I didn't like it because he was lying. And with that, I sensed that my mom was going to hand me over to him to hold. And I thought, oh, don't you dare. Don't you hand me over to that guy. He's a liar. And then when I felt my mom's arms reaching out to let this guy hold me, and I was thinking, no, Mom, can't you sense that I don't want to go to this guy? Don't you know that he's lying? So I started bellowing. I started crying, and I thought, oh, yes, she's taking me back. And then she took me back to the nursery, to my bedroom. But just before she took me back, I could see the surprise and the embarrassment in the man's face. That it was like he was embarrassed because I cried and didn't want to go to him. But that's my first memory.
Wow. And the crazy thing is that you have this memory from when you are, I mean, explaining as a week old. I know, like, in my case, obviously, I do not have memories of being a week old. But what I do know is that as I have studied out people that have been subjected to a lot of trauma in early childhood, one of these common threads, and for those of you that are listening, you can look into this. There's a lot of information coming out from various sources, even medically, showing that people that have been through significant trauma do retrieve memories from, well, as early as infancy. And so, Carolyn, why don't you start talking about some of the things that your mother was into spiritually. You know, she was part of the Theosophy Society. She had involvement with Ascended Masters and so forth. Why don't you kind of spend a little bit of time talking about that and kind of what impact that had on your life in an early childhood?
Okay. First, I'll mention some of the things that I knew she was involved in, and then if you like, I can always mention when it started for her.
Yeah, sure, please.
Yeah, and you know what? I would like to say that so often I wish my mother was alive today, because what she knew would really blow the cover off of what's going on today, because she really knew what was happening on the political scene from the foundation, before the foundation wow. of the United Nations, and she was into the political part. So, I mean, I understood quite a bit at a young age, at, you know, gosh, like 2, 3, and 4 years old. And even at that age, I knew of things that were going on in the United Nations and why, and that
wow.
that who was running the United Nations. And it comes from the other realm. But basically, to start off, I'd just like to mention that a few things I did know that my mother was involved in that people might recognize the names of today, and that was the Theosophy Society. And there's one called the Arcane School of Christianity, the New Group of World Servers, and there's one called the World Goodwill Organization, something called Triangles. There's all sorts of other groups that don't have names that, or maybe they do have names now that I'm not aware of, but there's lots of other little groups, too, that people like my mother would have been involved in. She had her own little study group that would come over at the house on Tuesdays and do their little practice sessions and then go out and do their assignments were. My mother also was a teacher out of the body. That's something we'll talk about
yes.
sometime. But there's not just the physical schools, there's schools going on in the astral realms. And some people like my mother were some of the teachers. And some
wow.
of the people that write for Lucius Trust, which used to be Lucifer Trust, they also do out-of-body teaching. So they're physical people in this world that are doing that right this minute. So, well, my mother started off, in our family ran psychism. And a lot of people consider it familiar spirits. Starts with
okay.
Just knowing that there's a psychic string that runs through a family line. That was her beginning understanding of it until when she was in, her senior year in high school. She was 16 years old, and at that point, an ascended master appeared to her physically and told her that, kind of told her some of the family history and told her that they had been watching her in from the supernatural realm. They call it the spiritual hierarchy.
Okay.
Ascended masters are a division of this, the Brotherhood of the White Lodge. There's also
okay.
the division that's blatant Satanism. Not everybody knows, and that not all the people like my mother knew that Satanism was a section of that. And they find that out late. That's what Illumination's about. And when you become illumined, you find out the old truth, the whole truth, and that Lucifer's the head of it, and Lucifer's Satan, and that Satan is real and evil. But we'll get into that also later, too. So
yeah.
my mother was, of course, thought she was serving God, the same thing I thought. Some of the best servers in this plan love God and want to serve God. So they are so devoted to the plan and working their little section of it because they want to help humanity. That's where my mother was. She thought she was a Christian. She thought she was a highly illumined Christian from what she was told. And, of course, that's what I was taught also. Highly illumined, not just from a physical, not just from a spiritual standpoint, but also the fact that the bloodline, she was taught not only by the Ascended Masters, but by her own grandfather later, after uh-huh. the Ascended Master had appeared to her, her grandfather, wait a second, I might have that backwards, but I know that what she told me was that her grandfather definitely had let her know that he was also serving in the division of the spiritual hierarchy.
Okay.
So I think that was before she, I'm sorry, I got mixed up on that.
It's okay.
I just know that she was told by her grandfather that he was serving in the supernatural division, but it made more sense to her, of course, after the Ascended Master contacted her. But she knew she was part of the bloodline of many generations, mm-hmm. working for a plan where they said the Christ would be the global ruler.
Mm-hmm.
And you got to remember what the word Christ means. It means anointed one.
Yes.
That's why when you ever hear me speak of Christ, I don't usually say Christ. When I'm referring to Jesus Christ, I want to put the Jesus in front of the Christ just because.
Amen.
I want to make that difference.
Fantastic. Okay. So at this point in your story, we are talking about your mom and some of the aspects of your family that really played a role into what you were born into. You're telling us that your mom was very knowledgeable about global politics because of her involvement in the spirit, basically the evil spiritual side of what's driving this planet towards where we're going. She had interaction with Ascended Masters, and you know, from a Christian perspective, when you ask what is an Ascended Master, I think the easiest way to just describe them is evil spiritual beings. The Bible describes many different orders of angels and different kinds of things, and there's a lot of spirits. And these Ascended Masters, like the one that appeared to you, when you say physically, you're saying that did it come out of the spirit realm to meet her?
Yes. Actually,
okay.
Yes, it did. And, well, there are different levels in the spirit realm, and the mm-hmm. highest of these Ascended Masters they're able, this is how I understood it, the different divisions and different levels, where the highest Ascended Masters could go down to the lower, heavier realms, and they can also interact on the physical level. However, it takes a great deal of energy for them to manifest physically, for any demonic form to manifest physically, it takes a great deal of energy. Mm-hmm. So that could go into a whole other topic here about that,
yes.
which maybe sometime we can talk about that. But they're here. I mean, and they don't have to physically be near you. They mm-hmm. can be, like the way we communicated was a telepathic type. You get sensitive to their certain vibration, and they actually can tune in to you, or the people that are in the organization, like us. They would monitor our thoughts, they would send us thoughts, and we would know if they tuned in on us. We would know that if we spoke against them, we were in trouble. Or,
wow.
I mean, there was no doing anything behind their backs. So I guess that happens, the fact that you belong to them. As long as you belong to them, it's like they have their spirit is in you, in a sense. You can be either Holy Spirit guided, or you can be guided by unholy spirits. Well, we were guided by the unholy ones. And
wow.
There's a pecking order there, too, where actually in our home, as long as we were serving their purposes and doing what we were required to do, mm-hmm. we were protected by them. Now that meant that the demonic entities that can cause you great physical harm or spiritual harm were kept at bay.
Wow. Hold on, I'm giving a little bit of break because it
too.
Seems like the feedback is coming in.
Mm-hmm.
Is there still feedback? What we're going to do, we're going to take a quick break. I hope my producer's listening. We're going to go to a quick break, and we're going to come back and continue without this feedback.
I'm gonna make a wish this Christmas. I'm gonna say a little prayer. I'm gonna stop here for a moment before the moment disappears. The world's in a hurry this December. The city streets and shopping malls. I wish we could slow down and remember the meaning of it all. Wherever you are, no matter how far, come back to the heart of Christmas. Live while you can, cherish the moment, and the ones that you love, make sure they know it, and don't miss it, the heart of Christmas. Let's make it feel the way it used to. Let's find the wonder of a child. You can see the magic all around you. Come on and open up your eyes. You can find it in the warm embrace of your family, or calling up a long lost friend.
Alrighty. Thank you, Jesus, that this feedback is coming to an end. I think we may have to have a transition in this program where I'm going to be calling in and we're going to cutting the video because I don't want this feedback to kill the interview. I apologize for those of you that are watching. Sometimes when you talk about things the devil doesn't like, he'll try to throw a wrench in it. But praise God, we're not going to let this get in the way. All right. Let's go back to a quick break, and I will be right back. Oh, praise. No, let's go ahead. Okay. Beautiful. Thank you, Troy. Carolyn, you're back with us. Praise God. You know, sometimes, man, when the devil doesn't like what you're doing, he'll try to trip you up. But I think we're back in the green.
All right.
For all of you that are listening, we've been interviewing Carolyn. My goodness, what she is sharing is just fantastic, revelatory. She's exposing a lot of how things work on the evil end of things. That things that, you know, we know about in the Bible. We know that our war is not with flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rule of darkness, and spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. When she's explaining to us some of these ascended masters, spiritual beings in the hierarchy and evil entities, what she's telling us is literal definitions on what we know in generalities from the Bible. I don't want anyone to walk away from this program thinking, wow, she's talking about some nonsense that we need to discard. No, absolutely not. Know that these things are going on. Know that these people, that there are people in this system interacting with these things, and understand that it's our job as Christians to understand constantly that we are at war. We have a responsibility to execute the victory of Jesus Christ against these evil agendas. And so with that said, Carolyn, I want to get right back into your story.
Well, can I say something here?
Yes.
What I want to say, in addition to what you just mentioned, is that, yeah, what I'm talking about is real, and we want people to understand that the dark side, they are the authors of the evil plan, and they are real. However, we need to definitely stress the point that there's no point in even bringing that out, except that we need people to know that there's power in Jesus Christ. That's the whole point of this whole show, is that, yes, they are real, but we need to know who we are in Jesus Christ and what power we have through him. And that's the important I just feel like I need to keep saying that, at least for myself, for people to understand that that's where I'm coming from.
Amen. So, jumping right back into your story, you're a child, you're born in, your mom is involved in all this stuff. Can you begin to tell us some of your earlier experiences being brought into this system, this way of thinking, this organization, and so forth?
Well, I was bombarded kind of from the physical and the supernatural realms. I keep flashing back to a time when I was 4 years old. I was given a lot of the information about the plan at that point, and about the bloodline, that I was taught that we were from, not even from this planet.
Wow.
That we were genetically, we were supposed to be superior. That there's a genetic line that through humanity that is of that organization, that we were called the Illumined Ones.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really care for the term Illuminati.
Mm-hmm.
And in some ways I think that term's kind of lame, because it's just see a bunch of, I kind of picture a bunch of men around a boardroom table sort of thing. You know, in a sense that's what it is, but the real power is in the supernatural realm. And aluminum ones, it can refer to people that are the humans, and it refers to things that aren't human, and that are just devils, demons and devils. So I was taught that my family is from several bloodlines that were specifically brought to Earth to guide humanity through, they believe in spiritual evolution and human evolution, physical evolution, which is a lie. That's another thing that can be another topic that can easily be disproved too.
Yes.
So I had that, along with I had my teachers out of body from like early childhood on. I had individual teachers. I had a teacher that would be taking care of a group of children, and we would, like, a small classroom. I was taught, I used to tell my mother about these things. She didn't implant this in my own mind. I would tell her a lot of times what I was doing in my nighttime excursions. She was in the organization. Okay, as a child, I was allowed to tell her some of the things that I did and some of the things I was learning. That was so that she could help guide me. But as we got older, neither one of us were allowed to tell the other what we were doing in our section of the plan, what our out-of-body experiences were, unless we were working on something together. And there were a couple of times where she and I were together on a certain project.
Wow.
However, as a child, out of body, sometimes, a few times I was with her. They do use, like, mystical horses, like a unicorn. I had my own mystical horse that would come pick me up. That was one of the first things that I remembered. See, I'm telling you this because children, because a lot of times the dark side may I don't want to instill fear in anybody.
Sure.
We all need to be praying for our children, and to we're our spiritual covering for our children.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a great responsibility, not just in the physical realm, but in the spiritual realm. Pay attention to your children when they tell you about their dreams. Try to pray for them before they go to bed. Pray for them daily,
Amen.
Constantly, if you can. It's so very important. Maybe they're having a dream about a horse or Pegasus. Maybe it's something that's more sinister than that. I had my own white horse that used to come get me. That was my trip into the heavenlies. I had what I called the moon fairy that used to come for me and teach me things and take me through the realms.
Before you go any further, Carolyn, so we don't lose anyone listening.
Yes, please.
This like magical horse that used to come. This was a spirit. It was not a literal horse that walked into your room neighing through the house. I just want to make sure everybody that's listening to this program doesn't take that away. Like, oh my, this one was talking, and you know, some corned horse would walk into a room. It's crazy. This was a spiritual thing, and what people have passed off as fantasy and folklore and different things like that, really, I believe, and she's kind of confirming just on this topic, are based on real spiritual things, things that do very much so exist in the spirit. And I think most people have no idea just how full the spirit realm is. So please, with that, just continue and go ahead and explain it.
Yeah, thanks, Daniel, because when I'm talking, sometimes I'm describing what I remember seeing, and I don't make it clear always that it was something that was not physical.
Yeah.
But yeah, in which you said about it being a spirit, it was a demonic thing. But they don't come like that.
Mm-hmm.
And so I described to my mother one time, I called them angels with blue bow ties.
Mm-hmm.
This is when I was like 2 years old. I still remember these beings. They were tall, they were feminine looking. Nothing like that in the Bible. There's nothing like that described in the Bible. But anyway, I don't think they're of God. No, I don't. But see, that's the thing. At that point, I thought they were. I don't know how I really got there. I think they must have called for me. But see, another thing, we need to be the covering for our children, mm-hmm. even when they're sleeping, not to fear, but just to know who you are in Jesus Christ and be able to pray for their protection and to have faith in that. And faith, of course, comes from not only experiencing the fact that you see God working for you, and I could give lots of instances, but I don't think I will. I keep thinking of one. It'll take too long to talk about. But,
It's okay. Just continue and tell us about these guys. Tell us about these teachers in the heavenlies that dealt with you as a young child, pushing you towards all of this that you were involved in with the plan. Let's just pick up there.
Okay. I had. Well, one of the things that happens when you're working in the organization, they a lot of times will continue to back up in the physical what you experience in the supernatural, a certain teacher, type of teacher that I might remember having, or a subject matter. A book will be put in my hands that actually will describe this or has that certain lesson written in it to back it up. But all it is just the demonic realm working to keep you in their clutches. So you think that you're on the right track. So,
wow.
I don't know where to go from next with that.
All right. So let's talk a little bit about this this school of the spirit, so to speak, because I think this is something that is really important for people to understand a valid element of your testimony and things that I've come across as well in reading accounts, particularly of witch doctors. But You described that you were taken to these places. You had teachers. There was a school of the spirit that you went to in spirit while you slept, and that then you would be returned and then live out your life on this earth to then go back to the school of the spirit the next night. Why don't you just kind of talk about that?
Okay. I remember I don't know if I've even told anybody about this. I remember one particular class. I considered it like a field trip class. The mm-hmm. students in there, it was like a student of six of us, six or seven of us. They're all my age, boys and girls combined. One female teacher. We were all human, mm-hmm. but she was our guide. Her, what she taught was the lessons were about evolution mm-hmm. of spiritual evolution and evolution of the earth and mankind. Well, I know that's a lie, but see what I'm, the only reason I'm mentioning it now is uh-huh. because I don't know who those other boys and girls were. They're like me, but mm-hmm. That is going on. And once you leave one class, you're taken to a different class, which is a little higher level. I ended up having my individual teachers. Then, of course, even though I knew my mother had her own ascended masters that she dealt with, and she was getting schooled on how to raise me. Also, she had several physical mentors that were helping her raise me, if you want to call it helping. You know, she did some mm-hmm. things to me that you wouldn't think that she was not a bad mother, but there were things she did to me that I know she regretted. But she was taking someone else's advice. So all that to say that I did get to a point where I had my own ascended masters, and I was also guided to do things, tag along to learn and also do it on my own. Some of the important things to know about is that sometimes when you are asleep, you can get your dreams influenced because there are not only demonic spirits, but they're humans like me that were trained to implant thoughts, to take you out of your body, to influence you, and also to meet up with you the next day to let you know that that was not just a dream. That I've done that before. I actually met people the next day or the next day to let them know that what they thought was a dream was not a dream. My mother also had that happen with her. So that's probably something a lot of people have never heard about. And I just want everybody to know it's important to know, but nothing to fear. It's just to be aware of and arm yourself.
Thank you. And on that point, Carolyn, because this is so one of the things I do, because I realized early on, the devil likes to attack people when they're at their weakest state, like when they're tired or sleeping. You're saying that he has humans that are trained in the spirit to go and cause chaos. There are also demons that go and cause chaos in people's sleep. What do you do if you're a Christian to armor yourself against this, so to speak? And the answer is you pray before you go to bed and you apply the spiritual tools that God has given us, like the blood of Jesus. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 12 that we overcame the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. When you plead the blood of Jesus as a Christian over your house, over yourself, over your property, before you go to bed, that blood is like a barrier that can prevent and does prevent the influence and attack of those working on the dark side. It protects you and your family. This is what the Bible and Jesus Christ allows us as his children. You can apply the armor of God according to Ephesians 6, helmet of salvation, breastplate of righteousness, belt of truth, feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. These shield us in the spirit from attacks. And that's how we can overcome these devices and these strategies of the enemy. And what she's sharing, I think, is so important because what it says is, this is real. We are at war, and yes, Jesus has made provision. So thank you so much, Carolyn.
That's absolutely true. That is absolutely true. I mean, what you're saying. I've been on both sides, and I can tell you that I wouldn't be alive today if it wasn't for the fact that that Jesus Christ is real, and there is something to the shed blood. You don't even have to understand it. And you claim it, and the dark side hates it. Oh, they can't stand that. There's power in that.
Wow. Okay. So we've kind of talked about this spiritual element. Now, I do want to kind of transition, because you kind of, according to the way I understand your testimony, had a double life, where you had the spiritual side, and then you had the physical side. And so we've been talking about the spiritual side of your early childhood experiences. In being either as specific or as general as you want to be on this, why don't you tell us some of what was involved in the physical aspects of your life as you were being raised up from birth as a young child?
Well, it's hard for me to separate the physical and the spiritual, because to me they're one and the same.
Okay.
What I can say is that I knew, because I was so dedicated to the plan, what I believed was God's plan but wasn't, because I was so dedicated to it, I wanted to influence as many people as possible, and of course that was encouraged. Okay, right now several thoughts are coming to my mind. One is, maybe I better talk about my first prayer, how that got started, how I got started knowing spiritually. See, if it wasn't for something that happened to me just before I really, really understood the plan, God made a point to intervene in my life, and that's the only thing that has, that's what's kept me to this day. That's what's kept me fairly sane, I could say. And what happened, even though I was used to seeing things in the supernatural, and I had actually received a healing at one point from a light that was, it was a spiritual entity. To this day, I really don't think it was good. My mom thought it was good, but I'm saying this to say I experienced supernatural things and actually a healing that I don't even think was of God.
Let's do this.
Yeah.
Tell us about this. Give us the account of this healing, which it's important, because people don't understand sometimes that the devil can heal too. That's something that the dark side does. Witch doctors do it. Shamans do it. There is a dark side to supernatural healing that's not of God. And why don't you just tell us your experience, and after that, immediately, tell us about the first prayer and that experience.
Okay. Well, you know, it's hard for me to... Okay, what happened was I had gotten my tonsils taken out. Now, this is another interesting story I might have to talk about in detail, because it's actually been... I was talking with Dr. Preston Bailey. I talked to him from time to time, and he's validated numerous things that have happened to me. He validated that the situation when I had my tonsils out was not your normal tonsillectomy and not the normal experience. And several other children at the same time that I knew who went through the same procedure. However, getting back to the story, I was in my grandmother's house. I was in her bed, and I had been throwing up blood. I was probably about 3 years old at this time.
Okay.
I just kept throwing up. I knew my mother was worried about me and my grandmother. Very, very sick. It was middle of the day, bright, bright daylight. All right, all of a sudden through the window to my left came this huge, bright light. I mean, brighter than day. It's so bright. And it came in through the room, came and encircled me. My mother was sitting on the bed next to me. She saw the light coming in. She saw it surrounding us. And I didn't feel like it was good. I was a little bit afraid. And my mother began to get up off the bed and back out of the room. She went backwards out of the room, closed the door behind her. And I don't remember anything else after that other than the fact that I had gotten healed. So I heard years later about this. See, I never talked to my mother about that story. A relative told me that after my mother's death, had told me that my mother had talked to her about that particular instance when I was healed. She told me that my mother said the reason that she left the room is she felt like that that light was good, and the light wanted her to leave. So I was left alone by myself with this thing that I didn't think was godly, but she felt was, and that's where her, her discernment was. And I was actually afraid, but she left the room, and she left according to what my relative said was because she felt like it was telling her everything was okay and that she should leave. So I will tell you this, that when there is a healing from the dark side, there's always a subtraction somewhere in your life, somebody else's life, loved one. There's going to be a subtraction. You don't get anything for free from the dark side. So we had lots of subtractions in our lives, let me tell you. So anyway, my next experience that I know that I can remember of seeing something like that, I honestly believe this one was of God.
Okay.
It was morning. Okay, you want me to tell about this one now?
Please.
Okay, it was morning. I was in my own home. I was probably about 4 years old is what I think. There was a bright light, very similar to the one that had come in and healed me, but this was a very, very bright light, fluctuating light. I don't know whether it became an angel and before my eyes or whether I saw it spiritually, but the light in my own mind changed to become I saw it as an angel, and I knew it was an angel.
Mm-hmm.
It said, it was looked like a man, and it kind of like the pictures you'd see in Christmas cards or pictures in the Bible of what an angel looked like. I don't remember that it had any wings. I just remember it was bright and shining. He said that he was an angel sent from God. He had a message for me from God that God wanted me to pray to him, and that good things would come through prayer. So he repeated it a few times to me to make sure I understood what he was talking about. He didn't tell me his name. He didn't tell me anything other than that was the message. Then when he knew I understood the message, he left. He turned. I could still see him as like an angel, but it went like he went through my window. I saw him go up into the sky and into the clouds and disappeared, just like people talk about how they saw Jesus disappear.
Sure.
But from that point, I went to my mother, and who was cooking breakfast, and I tugged on her shirt, and I asked her, "How you pray?" She looked really surprised, and she just said, "Well, why do you ask?" And I said, "Because this big, beautiful angel came and told me that God wanted me to pray to him, and the good things would come through prayer." My mother was so surprised that she just turned the oven off and walked me over to the Bible, opened it up, and I know today what she was reading was the Lord's Prayer.
Okay.
I was thinking about, while she was reading it, I was thinking, oh man, I don't know if I can remember all that. How am I going to talk to God like that? I think she probably saw my puzzled look, so she said, okay, when we go to bed tonight, I'm going to tuck you in and I'll help you pray.
Mm-hmm.
So that night, she tucked me in bed, and she just told me to be very still and to just talk to God from my heart, and that I might hear from God, but then I might not. So she left the room, and I, from my little girl heart, I don't remember exactly what I said to God. I probably said, "Hey, your angel just told me to pray to you," and it's like it's probably only a minute passed, but you know, to a little girl, it's like eternity. And I just thought, oh, well, I guess he's not going to talk to me. I guess he won't answer me. That's okay. Then all of a sudden, it was just, bam, my whole room was just warmth. Love.
Wow.
It's like the love from the heavenlies. But I know it was him. It was like I could see his face, but I couldn't. I could feel him smiling, and he was very, very happy, very loving, and I could hear his voice. It wasn't audible, but it backs up biblically. I didn't know it. I didn't read a Bible for years after that. I didn't know about the Bible. We just didn't read the Bible much in the organization unless it was to interpret it in a different manner. I can interpret the Bible so many different ways. I was taught that way. But basically, okay, getting back to the story, his voice was like thunder. I saw, in my mind, I saw mountains. While it was sounded like thunder, I saw a picture of mountains. And it sounded like, all of a sudden, from the mountainous sound, it would sound like I mean, from the thunderous sound, it would sound like water and soothing. And I thought, it's like mountain. It sounds like a thunder, yet it's soothing at the same time. And I felt like God was smiling and said, "Yes." He said, "That's my voice."
As
he showed
know,
me that he. Pardon me?
Oh, go ahead. No, please continue.
Okay. He showed me that he loves us all so very, very much that it's okay. I've mentioned this on our program before, and it's worth mentioning again here. Mm-hmm. He showed me a picture of like a father watching a daughter. Now you can picture it as a father watching a son mm-hmm. playing. There's nothing more important to God, our Creator, than you. I mean, sure, the universe is out there, but you are so very important to him, enough where he's going to sit down there and take pleasure in you. He showed me that it doesn't matter what I'm thinking. He knows what I'm thinking. Should I be ashamed? Yeah, I'm probably ashamed of some of the things I've thought of in my lifetime, but I know he loves me anyway. And all I have to do is ask him, "God, forgive me. Please help me be better." And I'm not ashamed to do that. He showed me that, and that's what I've needed my entire life to get me through. Also, he did show me some things that would happen in the future, and I can remember being really, really excited about it. And I mean, I guess I don't remember some of the bad things, but I was excited. There are some good things out there that I was going to be looking forward to. And I asked him if I'd remember it, and he said no. He was going to leave that in my subconscious mind as a guidance for me, but that some of the things I'd remember when I got older. But for now, it was just to guide me. Okay, now, that presence that he showed me that moment when I said my first prayer is the presence that I've gone to every, I mean, it's like I try to stay in that presence as much as I can.
Mm-hmm.
It's like I pray. I do pray every day. I pray throughout my day because of that.
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
that, when things seemed nutty in my life, just outright crazy, if I couldn't make sense of anything, why somebody said some things, why somebody did something, or something that happened to me that just made no sense, like, "God, why did you allow that to happen?" I didn't have the answer. But I knew that if I went back to that place, of that spirit of God, and I think we're all capable of reaching that and finding that part of God, that if we go to that, he's sanity. No matter how insane the world is, he is total sanity. He can get you through anything. So even if you don't understand something in your life, there's a purpose for it, and God's going to help you. And so that's what I got from that, and so I trust him. I don't understand now that I'm a Christian. I don't understand all the Bible, but I do understand the Spirit of God. I do understand the nature of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. That is something I can count on, and that's why I'm always stressing people to get to know God, because that's going to make perfect sense. When nothing else makes sense, he's going to make sense, and he's the healer. He is the healer.
And you know, later on in the future, when we talk, once we get into more of your story and begin to talk about how Jesus even heals memories, you know, that I think is just so important, especially for those that are going to listen to this program because they know about you and they know about what kind of background you are coming out of mind control, dissociation, coming out of the organization that you were a part of, being a part of the plan. And you know what? At this point, what I want to do, because we've been throwing out this term, the plan, or at least you have made several references to something that you call the plan. So before we go any further with your personal testimony, you know, beyond this point where God entered in and put a foundation that you could always go back to, what did you come to understand as the plan?
I understood the plan to be written by Lucifer himself and his top spiritual hierarchy. Some people know those beings as the Ascended Masters. And it's just like in Ephesians, what is it, Ephesians, is it 6:12? 6:12 talks about the, to me, that speaks of the spiritual hierarchy, that it's kind of like a military where you have your different levels, your generals, there's a pecking order, it's a hierarchy, and it's in the supernatural. He has authored a plan. It's very intricate, as you can see how many different ways of deceptions there are, and the ultimate plan, of course, is, first of all, Lucifer hates God and God's creation, hates humanity, and even most of the servers, the physical people that serve in the organization, don't really realize that Lucifer really does hate them, and he's going to use them. A lot of these people think that they're going to have positions even in the afterworld, so that keeps them going. Some just don't care. So the plan is it's a plan to bring a physical global order.
Okay.
A lot of people only know the plan as something that is to bring the Christ. They call it the Christ, their anointed one, to rule on planet Earth as the global ruler. And it really depends on what division you are, what level you are in this organization as to your understanding of what the plan actually is.
Okay.
Not everybody has the same understanding.
Wow.
But it's basically to destroy humanity and to lead you away from God, and if possible, to have you be destroyed spiritually, if that's possible. But the greatest thing that I think Lucifer likes to do is to take somebody that knows who Jesus Christ is and turn them against him. Turn them against Jesus Christ and have them serve Lucifer. That's like a trophy. So Lucifer has multiple goals in this. So the plan is like a multifaceted, huge conspiracy.
Right. Wow. Okay. So, but I think you've certainly given us a good answer to that question. You certainly can't. Well, from what I understand, you know, there's so many different directions to talk about what's involved. You can't explain it in two sentences, but to destroy humanity, to bring in a Christ and a global order, or at least attempt to, I think basically describes what the Bible reveals in reference to its prophecies about this same issue. So really, really just confirms what the Bible says. Now, so going back, all right, in your testimony, you've explained to us that you, from an early age, became part of, you partook in spiritual school in the heavenlies, as these creatures, spiritual creatures, will come and take you there. You learned things, you went through classes, in the physical, you know, you were here on Earth, but a lot of that, as you explained, was kind of meshed one the same. Can you begin to talk about, which is, I think, a big part of your experience, your introduction into trauma-based mind control? And you don't have to give us the graphic details, even if you can just give us some generalities, some scenarios, you don't even have to name names. Just how did that factor into your life and what you ultimately became as you were growing up?
Well, I didn't know that they were connected. I knew that I was being taken at night. And I even tried to tell my mother, and she wouldn't believe me.
Mm-hmm.
There were times where it wasn't just me. I had, my brothers were taken a few times, but mainly it ended up just being me. I had other relatives that were taken to other places also with me. I remember what happened, some of what happened there. The full memories haven't come back, but I've always remembered the being taken places and the beginning of certain things and then being brought back. But what happened in between was a blank. And now I know after other surface memories why it was a blank. There's certain procedures they do to block out the memory. Mm-hmm. So I think the first time I remember being taken physically out of my home, I was probably, I suspect that it was before I was 3 years old, things were happening to me. I don't remember. I don't have full memories until when I was like, I was about, I think around 4 years old. I remember it mainly the abductions, the ones out of my house at night. Now, there were ones that happened before when I was younger from other places. But when I was, I would say, five, seemed to be pretty active during the time I was five, six, and seven. There were things that happened to me when I was eight that I know of. This was back in the late 1950s, early 1960s. So some of my memories were, it wasn't until a few years ago some of these full memories started coming back. I could remember being taken at night. I can remember being brought back. I'm pretty sure I know who used to take me. I remember being drugged. I can remember when I was a little older, too big for one man to carry me out. Two of them would come in and get me. I mean, I was never a big person, but it's kind of awkward to carry a probably 100-pound or slightly less than 100-pound girl out the door quietly.
Yeah. Wow.
So, I can remember underground facility. I can remember experiments going on with surgeries. I haven't written about these. I haven't talked about them before. And I remember ceremonies of being taught about the satanic ceremonies. We can talk about that another time. But as for some of the memories, I remember, it was a photographic memory of being in, this is something I don't think I've talked about this yet before. I could identify these people. If I saw a picture of what they looked like back then, I'm absolutely sure I could identify certain people in my past. So I will be doing that because I think that, I know there are other people that have experienced some of the things I've experienced, and I'm finding out if I share with the right people, that will help other people. But basically what I remember from one complete memory, I understand how the mind control worked. I remember being hooked up with electrodes on my forehead, what the purpose of it was. I remember a horse trough where I was drowned. That was a procedure that after the electrodes would be hooked up, and I can talk another time about what I know of, or maybe I'll put it on my blog. I'll write it into my blog about what they did and why why they did it to me.
Okay.
I just have held back because I didn't want everybody to. I didn't want to put out information that shouldn't be out there, and I didn't want to let everybody know what I know or what I remember. But I think time where I probably could do that, but they would drown me and bring me back, and that was to help me forget, but also it was like sealing in a memory. They would layer in a demon within that particular program layer.
Okay.
This was just in one place. There were different places I was taken to for different things.
Wow.
So that was just where they had the machines hooked up, just like a picture that if you go to a site it's called endritualabuse.org, there's actually a drawing under mind control experimentation on children.
Mm-hmm.
And it's I think it's Ellen P. Latcher, PhD. I think that's her site, or she submitted it. Anyway, there's a picture on there that's almost identical to what I remember with the programming. And sometimes they would have, other times they would have one spinning, it would be like on an easel, something spinning that it's like black and white thing spinning that I'd have to look at. And sometimes they would have one in every place where I could would turn my eyes to, there would be an easel with that spinning thing on it, so that I couldn't look anywhere in the room without seeing it. So
wow.
That's just one of those memories. But I've with the trauma based, I think one of the they just things that they do to animals, and I won't tell about that. There's some terrible things,
okay.
Things that they have you to do to other people, and sometimes within you'll be in a hypnotized state where you're told you're doing one thing, and then you wake up and realize you're actually hurting a human, and then
wow.
you have to adjust to that. So, I mean, I get tortured by those those thoughts coming to me. That's hard to deal with, and that's where I have
yes.
to take Jesus there for the healing.
Mm.
Yep.
Okay. What you just said right there, there are people that are going to hear this show because we are talking about this topic. A strategy that you use is to actually take Jesus into the memory when it surfaces or you revisit it.
Mm-hmm.
And he heals it.
Yes. It seems so simple that it doesn't work, but this is something that Dr. Preston Bailey told me to do.
Uh-huh.
And I'm telling you that it seems so simple, but for some reason it works.
Wow.
The memory where I had an elderly couple that used to come pick me up, and they might take me away for an hour or whatever, you know. My mom thought I was out in my neighborhood playing. Well, I wasn't always out there playing. I would be taken for a short while. Well, with this memory and some of the places they took me to, it's hard to go back and relive that. But for some reason, just by me picturing Jesus or even the presence of Jesus with me and me holding his hand, sometimes it's like he reaches his hand out and holds me. I mean, some people consider visualization evil. You have to be careful with I can't even say it.
Yeah, it's okay. Visualization.
Yeah, you do have to be careful. But I'm telling you that if you think of this, pray to God, talk to our Heavenly Father in Jesus' name, you ask Jesus to be there with you in that memory. I've taken him with me, holding my hand, and all of a sudden I feel healed, so much peace. I get the peace about it, and the memory doesn't haunt me like it used to. Like I have certain memories that would just come to me daily, just flash before my mind, wake me up at night. But I take Jesus there, and it's like it loses its power over me. So it's working for me.
So let me, I want to, as you're saying this, I feel the anointing of God right now on this program because, not just right now, in the future, as this gets archived, played, people listen, people hear your story, people are interested, they want to know what's on the dark side. They want to know that someone else is out there, had these experiences. It's not just them. Yes, there are underground bases. Yes, there is mind control. Yes, all these things are real. And hold on, there is a supernatural strategy to heal from that background, and his name is Jesus Christ. And his method is, by the stripes of Jesus, you were healed. In 1 Peter 2:24, and I just got to say this, that's a past tense verb, you were healed. You know, the power of God, what Jesus did on the cross, transcends time and space. And so at any point in our lives that we live, God retains the power to heal even across time. It's not relevant when it comes to God's ability to step in, change our circumstances, heal us, and bring us into the victory that Jesus Christ purchased. And what you're saying, I think, just needs to be heard by so many people that have unhealed memories. And you don't have to be a victim of mind control to be healed by Jesus in your memories. You can do this just because you know that your memories suck. Excuse the language, but I mean, really, I want this, I just feel in my spirit, on me, that this is so important. And if there's one thing that Jesus wants to get across, it's that, man, does he have what you need? Does he have the healing that you need? And so, my God, thank you so much for testifying.
Yeah. And if there's something that just came to my mind, there are times where I have trouble forgiving, and I might have thought I have forgiven, or there might be bitterness. That's only hurting us. And maybe I feel like I can't forgive. I ask God. I say, God, please help me forgive. Please. And I know he's going to help me. He knows where I am. He knows my heart is that I want to forgive. And I don't feel guilty about the fact that I may not be exactly where I want to be in forgiveness, or maybe I'm not as good a person as I think I ought to be. God knows my heart. He knows your heart. So that's another thing I want to just encourage people to give themselves some slack, in a sense, and just know that if you ask God to help you forgive, if you ask God to help you to be a better person and a stronger Christian, to hear his voice, he's going to try to do that for you. It may take longer than you want it to, but just don't give up. Just keep praying to God. He is there. He is real. And he loves you more than you could ever imagine.
On that note, Carolyn, we're going to go to break. For those of you that are listening, you've been listening to Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall. We've been talking with Carolyn Hamlet, and we're going to finish off in a couple minutes.
I'm gonna make a wish this Christmas. I'm gonna say a little prayer. I'm gonna stop here for a moment before the moment disappears. The world's in a hurry this December. The city streets and shopping malls. I wish we could slow down and remember the meaning of it all. Wherever you are, no matter how far, come back to the heart of Christmas. Live while you can, cherish the moment, and the ones that you love, make sure they know it, and don't. You can see the magic all around you. Come on and open up your eyes. You can find it in the warm embrace of your family, or calling up a long lost friend. You can even find it in the eyes of a stranger when you reach out a helping hand. No matter how far, gonna make a wish this Christmas. I'm gonna say a little prayer. Wherever you are, no matter how far, come back to the heart of Christmas. Live while you can and cherish the moment and the ones that you love. Make sure they know it. Wherever you are, no matter how far, come back to the heart of Christmas. Live while you can, cherish the moment and the ones that you love. Make sure they know it. And don't miss it, the heart of Christmas.
All righty, and we are back on Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall. Now, you've been listening to a profound testimony from a woman named Carolyn. For those of you that are listening, you want to check out more of what she has to say, information that she has released about her experiences. You can find those at www.beyondthephysicalrealm.com. That's www.beyondthephysicalrealm.com. That's Carolyn's blog. And there you can find more about her story, other interviews she's done, things she's shared. She is just doing an incredible job as a whistleblower and also a child of God, pointing people to the truth that she has found in Jesus Christ. So, Carolyn, we're in the last part of our program, and, you know, we have about 20 minutes left, and I want to make the most of this time and let you continue to educate us on the things you experienced, moving forward from the foundation that God set in your life by sending that angel and teaching you to pray at that young age, and to find your stability in Him, really, even though you were so deep into so many things. So, picking up after that experience, why don't you go ahead and tell us some of the other events that began to occur in your life after that encounter with the angel?
Well, at that point, I still, of course, didn't know that the organization I was serving was not of God.
Mm-hmm.
I honestly believe that God did want me to experience certain things, and so that I could. This is just my assumption, going on what I've shared, like my pre-birth memory. Even if I didn't have that, I would just have to assume that God wanted me to experience what I experienced so that it could be used for good later. That's the only thing that makes sense to me at this point. Also, I know for a fact that He did get me out at the right time. This is something we possibly, if we have the opportunity, Daniel and I will have this at another time, talk about this, of how I actually got out of the organization. That's something I haven't even written about. It's kind of complicated, but when I do speak about that, you'll see why Jesus Christ is so important to me, and you'll see that also it was God that got me out. It was a supernatural event, because God Himself, I mean, I was so convinced I was working in God's organization. That's how deceived I was. I was so convinced that it did take an act of God to show me that I actually was serving in the evil organization. And I know it doesn't make sense now, but it will make sense later when I talk about this. So all that just to say that I did continue allowing myself to be schooled, wanting to serve God, being having spiritual teachers, thinking I was helping other people by getting them into practicing spiritism. That's another thing that I was encouraged to do. That I was encouraged to in my astral projection, also encouraged to increase my telepathic abilities, my remote viewing, practice levitation, channeling spirits. I had my own seances as young as probably 5 or 6 years old, and we definitely had believers from my seances.
Wow.
I won't go into using the Ouija board, you know, I don't want to teach any of that stuff, but I want to tell you that they are demonically, like the Ouija board, there are demons that actually wait to have someone use that and wait for demonic communication. Most of the ones that do communicate with something like that are very, very low level demons, meaning some of the most evil, devious demons, and they will subtract from your life. They will cause havoc in your life one way or another. It may not appear at first, but that may be in another program we can talk about how that happens. I can tell you what to look for, because you may not notice it and recognize it yourself, or your friend may not recognize it. That's the whole point, is they don't want you to tie that in with a subtraction. They want you to think that it's just a normal bad luck in life. Certain things happen, but
interesting.
I'm telling you, there's subtractions in your life, so don't mess around with that stuff. Don't even entertain the idea. The Bible speaks specifically against that for very good reasons. You don't need that. You know, if you have the Holy Spirit of God, that's the guidance you need. You don't need any kind of a demon spirit. You don't need an angel. You know, from my experience, you'd think that I would be telling people that I would be open to a lot of ideas when people say, oh, I had this vision or that vision, or I've seen a heavenly being. No, it kind of makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up, because I know so easily how people can be fooled. I don't even trust myself. I mean, I have to I'm telling you, if something appeared to me and said it was Jesus and actually felt like Jesus, I actually have had that experience, and we'll talk about that another time, but I would have to put it to the test. So I kind of got off topic there.
No, it's okay. And you know what? You said something, Carolyn. You said very low level. Can you please, from your experience, explain to us in the dark hierarchy what you mean by low level demons versus high level spirits? You interacted with both. You've actually seen it in your astral projections as you were part of this organization. Can you explain to us what you've encountered and kind of describe how that works, the way you understand it?
Okay. The ones that I mentioned that like to show up, and like poltergeist, demons that people say they channel, or they think that they're highly evolved beings. Most of those, if not all those, are very, very devious, evil entities that they thrive on causing trouble, and that's the way they hang around here on Earth, is that they have to draw energy, and they draw the energy from creating turmoil. Well, that's I could just go so in depth of that, but I'm not going to, because it.
Okay.
But they can be in a pecking order. They are subject to. There's like a higher level. Let's say the ascended masters. The ascended masters. They'd snap a finger, and those things would just be like whimpering little dogs. It's like they fear. Those things fear the ones that are closest to Lucifer, because those closest to Lucifer have more power than them. But they also, the ones closest to Lucifer, send those demonic troublemakers to do the dirty work.
Mm-hmm.
And they use them. So I don't think can ever appear. I've never known them to be able to appear anything as beautiful as like the ascended masters do. Maybe I'm wrong about that, but most of them that I've seen, like, I think they just like to appear hideous because that's what they look like. They love to scare people, and they love to entice people to do bad things, think bad thoughts, because that's where they get their energy from. So if you have a problem, see, the thing about the occult, if you have a weakness, a weakness with lust, whether it's food, whether it's alcohol, or you're prone to anger, these things will intensify that and encourage it, because that's where they get their energy. They feed off of that. So that's another reason to stay away from the occult, is that it intensifies any weakness you have and feeds off of that and destroys you.
Mm.
So, but they do, they only have a certain amount of power, in the sense that if the higher-ups in Lucifer's hierarchy don't want those things unleashed, then they will put a stop to it. So when my mother decided to quit working for the hierarchy, those things were unleashed on us. And my life was it was worse than the bedroom scene on The Exorcist. I was not possessed like that, but on a daily basis, I was beat up by demons physically. I mean, you can't fight. It's like being beat up by five big people at the same time and shouting obscenities, levitating my bed, throwing chairs at me. I had a table thrown at me. It's beyond the point of fear, where for me it was just anger and frustration.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
I didn't know. I did not know to call upon Jesus at that time. And if I had, uh-huh, I'm sure that could have been stopped. But see, that's what happens when you try to drop out of the organization. If you don't have the power of Jesus Christ, they will unleash their demons on you and your family.
Wow. So, now, going back to the issue of the Ascended Masters, you explained that they are, they kind of work with people, humans, they train humans, they teach humans things. Can you explain a little bit about your personal interactions with the Ascended Masters that you had in your experience?
Well, we used to, this was my young adult years, my main interactions with them.
Mm-hmm.
We had ceremonies. Some were in the physical, some were not in the physical. It's like the master, people might have heard of like the Master Hilarion. Well, he was they said he was Melchizedek. There's all mm-hmm. sorts of lies mm-hmm. who they say these masters used to be, you know, like incarnated.
Okay.
That's maybe, that could be another show, because I could certainly shoot all that down.
Okay.
There were ceremonies that would take place. There were times where we supposedly saved people's lives or saving them pain from dying by encouraging them as they were just before, if there was going to be an accident, we'd let them know there was going to be an accident, and we would ask them to come with us, leave their bodies, that they wouldn't feel any pain.
Oh, my.
That's kind of a scary thought. I thought we were working for God, but we were not. So what does that mean? Some people didn't go with us. Some did.
And you did this in your what you would call the astral form. You were in spirit,
yes,
when you would do these things. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Better make that clear. Also, there's a, just before I left the organization, we are involved in making human bodies, actually making bodies for Lucifer's top hierarchy.
Wow.
And, yeah, this goes along, I guess, it's a kind of like with the Nephilim mothers, Doug Riggs, Pastor Doug Riggs has talked about.
Sure.
In fact, some of my story, I mean, I've gone through a lot of my experiences since I've gotten out of the organization and recalling memories. I mean, this was something I always remembered about the creating the bodies. But mm-hmm. some of the things that people want to laugh at are just, they can't believe with what Doug Riggs, what the Nephilim mothers have experienced.
Yes.
And some of the reoccurring, how their memories are surfacing. I mean, and in some ways I consider myself like a kind of like a control of the whole thing, meaning like, you know, in an laboratory you always have a control that's not connected to anybody else.
Yes.
I mean, I've been, much of the memories that I didn't have full memories of, the memories that have surfaced to become full, like I may have had partial memories and the rest mm-hmm. come back, it fully mm-hmm. backs up, as far as I know, is backing up things that people don't believe about other people
wow.
that have gone through this, that actually they say, oh, well, you know, these Pastor Riggs has programmed these people. Well, he didn't program me. Yeah, for me to experience, to have certain memories come back to me and how things were done to me. No, it's just happened by itself. And in fact, I mean, I'll get relieved when I find out that something I thought was not normal, or I'm wondering, I'm going into convulsions. What's this all about? You know, when a memory's coming back, I can't help myself. I don't know what this is. What is this, God? And I'll find out it's a normal response that other
wow.
people like me are experiencing. So
mm-hmm.
I get peace. I'm thinking, oh, okay. That's okay. Or like Dr. Preston Bailey will tell me, he has a name for maybe something that I say, this is happening to me. And he'll go, oh, that's called this and that. And I'll go, oh, okay. it gives me peace and I can relax and be healed. Okay, so I know we only have a couple of minutes. I can't remember with that.
Let me say this. Pastor Doug Riggs, if you want to know what she's talking about when she references him, you can go into our archives, because we, on Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall, interviewed Doug Riggs, as well as several of the women and men that he has counseled, talking about the conception experience of what the Bible defines as Nephilim, or present-day angel-to-human hybrids, direct conception events. They talk about that because in the process of counseling, they have retrieved these memories of actually being involved, those that he is counseling, being involved in this agenda. You can also go to www.dougriggs.org to check out his website and other teachings, interviews, and so forth that they've done to get this message across. She references Dr. Preston Bailey, dear friend of mine as well. We've interviewed him on this program. Also, you can go into our archives and find out some of the things that he has to say. And so, you know, this is a... this thing is so big, and we are just scratching the surface with what you've been able to share with us this week, Carolyn, because, man, you know, at so many junctures in this conversation, we could have gone left, we could have gone right, we could have gone up and down in all kinds of directions with what you know, what you've experienced, which is why I'm telling our listeners, we will be having her back, and we will be going into, in the future, a lot of these experiences that we simply didn't have time for today. Something to look forward to. And, you know, with the last couple minutes, Carolyn, I just want to give you the opportunity to kind of explain to us, in short, what led you to start your blog, and then also tell our listeners how they can, what they'll find on your blog.
Well, my blog is kind of like it's not organized. There's a lot that I've written I haven't put up there. What I started out posting was a friend of mine actually set it up for me and encouraged me to post some of my information that I'd written it, I don't know, probably as early as 2005, maybe sooner. I'd been posting on forums around the internet, and I just took some of my posts and just put them on my blog, just kind of randomly, so that it would get some of that information out. Uh-huh. So that's basically what it is. There's no real there's no real structure to it, and everything that I've written, there's so much more in between, and my whole story hasn't been told, and really needs to be put out there, especially how I got or why I got out of the organization, you know, the whole thing, because that's the most important part, and I think Daniel's the one to help me to help me make that sense, make sense of that for everybody.
We are going to be doing that in the future. So, in any case, we are at the end of our program. We are out of time. Carolyn, I just want to say thank you so much for coming on this week, sharing with us all of your experiences. And for those of you that are listening, this has been Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall. Again, her website, her blog is...